One, and we are officially live. What's up, man? It's Mike Wall, and welcome back to another episode of the Agent Revolution Podcast, where we deconstruct some of the biggest challenges facing today's real estate agents so that they can build a sustainable, profitable, and most of all, fulfilling real estate business. Man, I'm stoked today. I got my buddy Matt Plumer in the house. Plumber, I did it, brother. I did it. You know what? You put that in my mind, and I did it. And I'm really excited to talk to you today, man. I met Matt at the shareholder summit in a couple weeks back, and I remember we were in Albie Stasek's agent attraction seminar, and you and I got to talking just after that, and you were telling me about some of the stuff you're doing, and I thought, man, what a great idea to get you on to talk a little bit about some of the things that not only that you've done, but that you're doing with other agents. So without further ado, welcome to the show, Mr. Matt Plumer.
Awesome. Thanks, Mike. Appreciate you having me on.
You're very welcome, my friend. Why don't we do this? I always like to start out, just give a little bit of a bio on yourself. Tell the audience about like where you came from, how you got into real estate, and what you've been doing over the last few years.
Sure. Absolutely. Appreciate it. So, quick backstory. My wife and I live here in Northern Virginia for the last almost 20 years, and have fallen, fell into just really the average, the run of the mill lifestyle that people do, whether they live in Northern Virginia or Central Ohio. And that's just simply living beyond their means and, just kind of going with the flow of life. Mm-hmm. And that's just, that was the trap that we were in. You know, we were always trading our time for money, regardless of what our jobs were. I was in a commission-only sales role for over a decade. My wife is a traditional, employee in corporate America. Mm-hmm. And so over those years of just trading time for money, our lifestyle just always kept creeping up to or exceeding our income. And I'm selling, at that point I'm selling, a $3,000 move and making, $250 or $300. So I've got to do a lot of that.
Yeah.
My lifestyle had, like I said, always generally was a rambunctious. I always called it a yo-yo lifestyle. So if I was either all in or all out.
Yeah.
And so that affected my life. I gained a ton of weight. I always fought weight as a kid, mm-hmm. But also as an adult. So I actually ballooned up to almost 300 pounds. Addictions had creeped into my life. I was always have this addictive personality. So I was addicted to gambling and alcohol and cigarettes and fast food. And so my moment came about 7 years ago, where I was 300 pounds. And I had that moment where I sat down with my wife and we just had to make those changes. And so started with a weight loss journey. I ended up losing 100 pounds in 11 months. Along that journey, we started a business. We actually got exposed to a couple online businesses that allowed me to go help other people in the networking space and social media. And I actually became sober, and our marriage changed. And actually, along that journey, we found and accepted Jesus into our lives. And all of that and all of the great things that were happening in our world, we had no idea the stress that we were under when it came to money. We were making great money. However, we never had any. And at the end of 2013, after all of those significant changes and transformations, we found ourselves in over $550,000 of complete debt, including a house, cars. A lot of people don't count their mortgage as debt. And I'm just here to say, we'll dive into that a little bit more, but it's still debt, right? You still owe the money. You still owe the bank the money. And so when you added it all up, it was $553,000. And, we were making good money, but we were paying so much out that something had to change. And we got exposed to some information through Dave Ramsey, who has an amazing following and system, and just absolutely followed those steps. So what started as a weight loss journey ended up as a financial and transformation journey. And then it seemed like a long time, but it was only 40 months. We actually knocked out every single cent of the debt.
That is amazing, man. There is so much to unpack there. Start with this, man, because I know a lot of the people that watch our show, man, they're in that daily grind like you were, you know what I mean? And they're hustling and they're making, some of them are making great money, and some of them are living that fast lifestyle. You know, they're eating fast food, or they're eating out and going to, you know, really nice dinners, and, you know, and maybe drinking every night or every other night. And what I don't want this to be, this is not like a, we're not, this show is not to make people feel guilty about their lifestyle. It's simply to make you aware. And I know, Matt, that's where you're coming from. But like the reality of it is, it was a wake up call for you, because, you know, when you do this for so long, it, you know, the end result is, you know, you end up like you were, right? Where you got into this place where you were overweight, you were not happy with your life, and something, you just felt this void. So like, if we can shorten that path for other agents and other people who watch the show, what are the signs to kind of look out for? Like, how do you get there?
You know, that's how you get to that point is so easy. You know, for me, when I look back of all the stuff, right, when I made the changes, I look back and was like, why did I drink so much? Or why did I eat so much? Or why did I spend so much money? And it comes down to one simple thing, Mike. It's pure boredom. We get bored. And when we have boredom or white space on our calendar, that's when the devil comes in. Mm-hmm. That's when we just have these, you know, inclinations to just do other stuff than what we're supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
And especially as real estate agents, when we're on this island by ourselves and we should be doing one thing, but we go do 20 other things, you know, whether it's, you know, in the real estate world, the lead generation and the activity, but we go do all the other stuff because we're bored. Yeah. Or you're just, you isolate yourself, I should say. So, I would look for those key things of boredom. Are you getting off track easy? Are you becoming distracted easy? You know, what are those, and then identify what are those distractors in your life? You know, is it social media? Is it the internet? Is it the knocks on the door? Is it the gotta minutes? Whatever it is, those distractions are really what's going to pull you. And then that's when you become bored and you either check email or you just go down the rabbit hole of, you know, whatever it was. For me, it was gambling. It was going to the bar. It was hanging out with my buddies. For some people, it's other things.
Yeah. So like, what for you, like, what was that moment of like clarity for you where you were like, you know what, this is it. Like, I'm done.
So a couple things. The very first one was when I did have a rock bottom moment from a combination of gambling and drinking. And I just saw the emotion and the love and the care simply with one comment or one conversation with my wife. It was gone. It was just, everything was just sucked out of her. We were in counseling. I didn't fit on the couch. I literally didn't fit on my counselor's couch. That was the moment, right? That was the feeling I had. You know, when it came to the money at the end of 2013, I looked and added up how much money we spent, and we were spending $2,000 to $3,000 more, which was in that case, in that time, about 20% more than what we were earning. And we had that rock bottom moment, man, where we pulled the last bit of money out of a line of credit that was it. That's all we had.
Yeah.
To make it through the next 3 months. So, you know, it was a lot of different moments, you know, and that's really kind of how I got to where I am today with, you know, being in the real estate industry, being a coach in the real estate industry, and really, you know, helping agents solve those problems, avoid those landmines, create wealth, create that exit strategy, and go build a big business.
Yeah.
And so, a big life.
And an amazing life. Absolutely. So, okay. So, you know, you get to that moment of clarity and you know that this is not where you want to be anymore. And, you know, certainly for folks, hopefully it doesn't have to come to that rock bottom moment for you. You know, maybe you make that decision right now in your life. And you know, maybe it never comes to that. Maybe you hear this show or watch the show and, you know, you start to make changes immediately in your life. But, you know, to the point of making a lot of money in real estate, I want to specifically speak to that, because let's say, you know, you're a young guy or gal, or you're mid 30s or early 40s, and, you know, you've never made the type of money that you're making now in real estate. What are some of the things that need to be on your radar when you get to that point?
So great. And, you know, it's not talked about in any real estate school and in any brokerage or any training class. Money is just not talked about.
Yeah.
And so, and I think that's why one of the things that, you know, actually building a true, you know, a business where the money's involved is not never really talked about. So the first thing is you have to have, however, what is talked about are systems and models that you have to, you know, here's what works. And if you just duplicate it, and so you're going to have a big real estate business. So if you just find that those principles on the financial side, you reach out to coaching, you reach out to people who have done it, you reach out to the mentors and the right podcasts, like shows like this, that are going to guide you to what are going to be the right business principles and what are the filters that my money has to cross through so that, one, I make a profit. Two, I actually can have a living and a life. Three, you got to pay Uncle Sam. And four, that's what's left. Whatever's left is what your business operates on.
Yeah.
And so many people have it upside down, that where they go make, you know, a $10,000 commission 12 times a year and they make 120 grand. The first thing they do is they go spend money, because they're taught through elementary school and finance classes all the way through college is that, and, you know, in taxes, they have other agents say, hey, go spend all your money so you don't have to have so you can have all the tax deductions. Well, all you did was just go buy a bunch of printers instead of have that fund your life, or, you know, color toners or computers or trips that simply it stole from your true profit or your lifestyle. So I would encourage you to do in those four steps. And then on the personal side, you got to avoid the debt. You cannot borrow your way through and you can't borrow your way through life and expect to win with money. You just can't do it.
Okay. So, like, you know, in real estate, I know, like, it's funny because I talk to so many different people who get into tax trouble in real estate. You know, either they got bad advice or they just simply didn't take out the money. You know what I mean? And you know, they get the IRS always comes knocking, right? And, you know, you turn in, you file your taxes and you get a big tax bill back. And it's like, when you talk about, like, when you make a statement like, you know, they don't talk about money, it's like they truly don't. They don't even, most people, you don't even get good tax advice, because a lot of this stuff would never happen if you'd just talk to people, or if you'd get the information out, where, you know, where these agents are getting into trouble by not paying taxes, right? And you know, and so for me, it's like, well, how do we, when somebody comes into your circle, Matt, like, where are they usually at? Like, because I know you do some financial coaching. Where are they, like, when they come into your circle, where are they usually at? Are they, like, completely ignorant? Have they gone through some struggles? Talk a little bit about that.
Sure. The person that's going to come to me is, I mean, they can really be anywhere. Because I'm not the get out of debt guy, right? That's Dave Ramsey. I mean, he's been the big get out of debt guy for, you know, for 25 years or 30 years. However, I know his principles like the back of my hand, and we're going to work through that. But I see so many people that come to me that owe the IRS thousands of dollars, tens of thousands of dollars, maybe even hundreds of thousands of dollars. I see people with car loans and car leases that come to me. And I see people with, you know, I don't see too much student loan debt, obviously, in this space too much. Although I do see a couple of people that have a stay-at-home spouse, and they have $50,000 of student loan debt, and they haven't worked in 10 years.
Yeah.
And so I'm trying to balance, you know, it's just one of those things that's like, nah, man, I mean, you got to get rid of it, or else it's just going to be there. I mean, it's really a lot. I mean, everybody has, you know, one of my clients now is absolutely smashing it in business. They don't have any debt. However, they're not leveraging their business to where it's funding investments for the future.
Yeah. And so elaborate that on that a little bit, because I really want people to get ingrained in what you're about to say.
Yeah. So, I mean, just because I'm a financial coach and I'm going to help you get out of debt doesn't mean that it stops there, or just because, you know, that's the end of the train. That's really the start, because that gets you back to zero. Right. I mean, when I started this journey 5 years ago, our net worth was negative 120,000 bucks.
Yeah.
And so paying off all the debt and then, you know, getting the cash actually got us back to even. And so once you have no debt and you have a little bit of money in your savings account, that's like ground zero.
Yeah.
However, so many people live below ground zero, it feels like the top of the mountain.
Sure.
And so they quit. And they quit on their activity, and they quit on their dreams, and they quit, and they just stay there. They go from contentment to complacent.
Yeah.
And the ability that we have as real estate agents to go and generate a massive income by serving a large amount of people, whether it's through real estate or through other vehicles inside of real estate, we can then go take that money and leverage the amazing vehicles that are out there, like the stock market and mutual funds, like buying investment properties, like owning businesses. You know, we get sold this pipe dream that being a real estate agent is, hey, you're a business owner. You barely own your job.
Yeah.
You barely own it. And so when we get people to zero and ground zero, and we can get them to see the vision of, hey, now every $1,000 that you make more than what you made last month, instead of paying debt, we get to put that into the stock market or mutual funds, or we get to put it into, you know, the variety of different vehicles that you can to generate wealth over the next 10, 20, 15, or 15, 20, 30 years.
Right. And you know, man, this really gets my blood boiling, man, because it's like, I've been there, you know, I've been there. And so when I see agents who all are just about like sell, and they're not creating any sort of a platform for growing their wealth, it scares me, man, because like, you know, at some point you're not going to want to sell houses anymore. You know what I mean? And so, you know, I talked a little bit about this yesterday or maybe the day before, but you're in real estate, you're only as good as your last transaction. Like then once you close on a deal, it's about, you know, what's next? What am I going to do next? Right? Because the reality of it is, excuse me, you wake up every morning unemployed and, you know, you got to go out and find a job every day. And who wants to do that for 20 years or 25 years or 50 years or however long it is you work? Like, you know, either you're going to work for your money for your whole life, or you're going to work for your money and then your money's going to work for you. Right?
100%. You know, I'm blessed to have so many amazing mentors in the space of business and leveraging, you know, either other people's efforts or leveraging systems to truly generate some massive amounts of income. And, you know, real estate, albeit that great vehicle that you can go as a solo agent, I mean, you can go out and ball it out and get 25 or 30 transactions a year. Once you get that fine-tuned, it is a rhythm. However, every time you work, you're going to make that transaction and that dollar stops.
Yeah.
Like the flow of that money stops. And I was having a conversation today with a gentleman who makes well over $1 million a year, well over, closer to probably 1.5 or 2 million. And we were talking about real estate and a couple other different businesses. And so I said, you know, I can go and spend 20, 30 hours to go lead generate to find a buyer or two or a seller or two and go and make, I'm in the market of, you know, we sell a $400,000 house and we make 10 or 12,000 bucks. That's great, which is a great commission check. However, the time that you spent to get that one check, that dollar stops. Now you might get a referral or two, mm-hmm. and you might get some ancillary business from that, which is all great, which is what we have to do as agents. However, the dollar stops. And so if you know, plugging yourself into a vehicle like EXP and the revenue share or other industries like a franchise where you truly own the business and somebody else is running it and it's, you know, they're paying Orange Theory Fitness. you know, they're billing $150 a month, $159 a month. My card gets hit every single month. And the owner of that thing doesn't spend an hour a week in that business.
Yeah.
So it's just, I mean, we can go create so much income and then leverage it out to other systems. I would highly encourage it to go knock it out of the park as fast as possible and build something else or build something while you're doing it.
So Matt, here's my question to you, man. And you probably got a better answer to this than most because you see it. You're on the front lines every day. Why don't people understand this? Like what I don't get is like, it's like death, you know what I mean? And I know that's a little morbid, but we never think about death, right? You really don't think about death until, you know, you get close to dying. And most people don't think about their long-term financial situation until they're in trouble. And I want to know why that is.
Well, the thing with death is, here's the thing about with death. It happens 100% of the time.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no way around it. There's a way around everything else in life other than dying, right? But with the money, we're never taught. You know, I'm 41, and my parents were never taught how to handle money through any type of elementary or high school or business for 40 years.
Yeah.
And you learn money, you learn from your parents. You know, more is caught than taught at home. You learn money from your parents. And there's a really good chance that your parents were never taught how to handle money. You know, if you go back two generations, they didn't have credit cards or very, very little. Three generations, it didn't exist. Debt did not exist.
Mm-hmm.
Like you were frowned upon if you owed somebody a dollar.
Yeah.
And then as we get into this culture of swipe and insert chips and Apple Pay and everything else, one click buy. That's the culture of today. And if you have a 10-year-old and you're 40 and you don't know how to handle money because you still have student loans and you live on credit cards and you got two BMWs with $1,000 payments in the garage or in the driveway and $500,000 mortgage, you haven't taught your kids anything. So they're seeing that.
Yeah.
Then they go to, and again, you're going down the hole that I'm going to tick somebody off. But I mean, they get to college, they get to 17 or 18 and there's no money. So yeah. What's the kid do? The kid signs his life away for $125,000 to go to college.
Yeah.
And then it just starts to cycle over. And so, and it's not being taught there and it's not being taught in the marketplace. So the challenge, I mean, it has to start at home with parents. Or it has to start in the marketplace with business leaders. That's really the only two places it's going to start because it's not going to start in school.
So like, obviously there's a lot of different areas in which you can invest your money to create, you know, passive or semi-passive income. But if you could talk about one thing, if you could get one message out about, you know, folks who are making really good money into real estate, like in terms of an investment or creating some sort of a strategy for passive or semi-passive income, what would you recommend they do?
The very first thing they have to do is they have to get out of debt. I don't care if you're making $50,000 in GCI or $5 million in GCI. If you have consumer debt, you're never going to make it. It's never going to get to where you want to go.
Why is that important?
Because what it does is it steals your wealth. So the largest wealth building tool that agents have, and anyone has, but real estate agents have, is their income. It's the largest wealth building tool. And if you have over on the left, if you have $10,000 over here, but you have $3,000 a month going out to payments, there's the delta's not enough to go invest. Mm-hmm. So the first thing you have to do is you have to eradicate the debt. And then once you do that, I would encourage people to leverage, you know, really good mutual funds, you know, and then I'm not going to get into the investing. I'm not an advisor, but I'm a huge proponent of high quality mutual funds and, you know, real estate that's almost paid off or if not 100% cash flowed real estate.
Yeah. You know, it's funny and like, I think it's great advice. I really do. And I think that, I think another place that, you know, people are simply ignorant or just haven't done the research is, and certainly I'm not a CPA and don't claim to be, but I still talk to people, man, that are real estate agents who are sole proprietors. And it's like, dude, like, you're missing the boat, man. You know what I mean? Because what one thing they don't understand is, you know, they're paying taxes before they're paying anything else. And the great thing about LLC formation is that typically what you spend, like you were talking about before, if you do have to buy printers or desk or computers, and in some cases you can include your car or your mileage or things like that, is that, you know, you can write a certain portion of that off and then pay taxes on what's left over. But what I guess the whole thing, the strategy behind the LLC is certainly that it does create some business savings. But the whole point of that rant was the fact that there are still people filing as sole proprietors. And that just, that to me, that puts the exclamation point on the lack of financial education in our industry. Would you agree?
Yeah. And, you know, I think that's also going to, I mean, real estate agents need to be real estate agents. And they need to find and align themselves with the tax professional and the financial professional that's the most savvy. I mean, reach out to your community and find the people and interview them, because, you know, and learn and educate. You know, whether you read the books or you listen to the podcast, I mean, at the end of the day, there's one way to do it, and there's the right way that you're going to, you know, pay as little as taxes as possible, or it's everything else where you're going to pay the most.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's never been my strong suit. So I do have professionals, and I'm surrounding myself with other CPAs around the country that do know, and they know those strategies, on how to, you know, diversify your, you know, and set up everything to where you pay as little as tax as possible. Investment advisors, you know, there are ones that specialize in, the growth of when you want those investments to start maturing and taking out, limiting your tax liability there. You know, I think, you know, we're in a market, a economy now of 2019 where, I mean, the taxes have never been almost lower, right? I mean, we're making more money and paying less taxes now than we've ever have. And it's only going to get more expensive. So, for the next 20 years, I mean, it just probably is. So and that's when people are retiring. So, I would encourage people to limit their taxable, like, strategize now, pay the tax now, so that you don't have to pay it when, and you have more money in retirement or in your years where you can go live a larger lifestyle.
So here's what everybody's been waiting for, man, myself included. For those of us who are in debt or still have debt, how do we start digging our way out?
You know, a lot of it, we talked about it earlier, a lot of it's awareness, because debt is so commoditized, it's so normal, people don't realize they have it. You know, it's so much, I talk to people, Mike, about, like, you know, when I was like, how much do you owe, you know, how much are you in debt? And they're like, oh, I have, you know, $20,000 of credit cards. And then it's like, well, what about student loans? Oh, I have that. And it's, oh, you got a car payment? Oh, I have a car payment. They don't realize that it's actual debt, right? It's just so normalized. The first step, the very first step to really unpacking and digging out is simply writing everything down, grabbing a legal pad and putting everything on paper. Print out your bank statements, go 3 months back. You're going to get a really good snapshot and just write down all the stuff. Pull out your wallet. Look at all the cards. You know, that's one thing that I do when I educate and I give people. I have 3 pieces of plastic in my wallet, and like $5 bills or 5 bills, right? My wallet doesn't weigh anything. Everybody else's wallet's this thick.
Yeah.
And it's not full of money. Trust me. So so it's being that aware, putting it on paper. There you go.
Not bad.
Yeah. No, not bad. But what I do is I give them my wallet and then they pick up their wallet, and it's like this.
It's like George Costanza's wallet. Remember George Costanza?
Yeah. And I'm like, that thing was like that thick. And I'm like, that's your life and your debt that you're carrying around.
Yeah.
Right. And so I would say, and all joking aside, just know the numbers.
Yeah.
And then once that's done, if you're really ready to say, I'm done with debt, you have to just draw a line in the sand and just say no more.
Yeah.
You can't get out of debt if you keep borrowing money on your Amex. You can't do it. It's impossible. So saying no and then getting on just starting a written budget. Just start there.
So write everything, get a pen and paper and just write everything out and try to create a budget for yourself. And you really just start attacking those payments, right? That debt, you pay a little extra, right?
Yeah. So the principles that I follow is once you have that budget, the Dave Ramsey baby steps, and I can go through them very, very quickly and efficiently, is baby step one is we've got to get $1,000 saved in the bank. Mm-hmm. That $1,000 of cash sitting over on the left over here is just enough to keep us from borrowing money, mm-hmm. right? That's going to fix an alternator. That's going to take care of an HVAC fix. It's not going to replace one, but it's going to put a Band-Aid on it to get you to the next day. Mm-hmm. So get $1,000. That's a buffer, right? That's a buffer between you and something bad happening. Baby step two is we pay off all of the debt. We list our balances smallest to largest. And we attack, and once we have that budget, we have whatever's left, we attack that first debt. And so we get that emotional win. Most people, Mike, want to pay off the highest interest rate, or they want to pay off the highest payment amount, right? The highest monthly payment. It doesn't move the needle. It doesn't get them that win.
Yeah.
People have to see a victory. When I was losing weight, I couldn't do CrossFit, paleo, be vegan, and I don't know if you can do be vegan and paleo at the same time, but whatever. but I couldn't do all of that and go run a half marathon, right? Yeah. I had to drink a shake instead of going to McDonald's, and I had to see 2 pounds go down on the scale.
Right.
Same thing. You have to pay off that $465 Home Depot card. You have to, and then, regardless of the other ones, you have to pay that one off first, and then you go to the next one, and then you go to the next one. You start this snowball, and it just builds up and builds up, and it works. And you have to be able to say no to saving, retirement, extra stuff, vacations. You just have to say no for now and get that debt knocked out as fast as possible.
Yeah. Because if you get that debt knocked out, then you can start making, when you talk about retirement and stuff like that, you can start making hefty payments or hefty investments into those accounts, right? And they grow exponentially.
Sure. I mean, just think, let's just use the number $10,000. If you have $10,000 coming into your household, so let's just, regardless of what your agent level, income levels are, let's just say it's $10,000 a month coming into your house. Mm-hmm. And $3,000 a month is paying off debt, right? That's your snowball. Mm-hmm. And then $3,000, once that's done, maybe let's jack it up to four and cut lifestyle so we pick up some momentum. Then we get a fully funded emergency fund. You're in real estate. You've heard that, emergency fund and savings, all that stuff. So get that sucker up to 3 to 6 months. That's baby step three.
Yeah.
And then now you have $4,000 that you've taken out of that $10,000 income. And now you can start chunking 15% of your income into a retirement. Mm-hmm. That's baby step four. So now you're putting of that $4,000 that you've created, now that snowball, because you're living on six, you're paying on four, you're saving it. So now 1,500 of that's going into retirement. Kids' college is baby step five. Mm-hmm. So if you've got a couple of kids, you figure out the math with your advisor. Now you have $2,500 left. So you start chunking that at kids' college. So now your kids aren't going into debt when they go to college. and whatever's left, you throw it at the house.
Got it.
That's baby step six. And baby step seven is build wealth and give tremendously. Yeah. All the way through it. We weren't givers when we started. We didn't know Jesus. We didn't know tithing. We sure as heck didn't know giving. As we went through our journey, giving has become the number one thing. When it was, you know, when I was doing a budget and I went all the way down, I was like, there's no room for giving. Like, we've spent all the money.
Yeah.
Well, I had my budget upside down. So I moved giving here, and now giving is our first line item, and 15% of our retirement is in the second line item in our budget.
Yeah.
That's, so when you take that, when you take that stuff first, it's done.
Yeah. It makes a lot of sense, man. It does. And I'm right there with you. Tithing and giving, you know, it you can't outgive God, you know what I mean? And it's amazing once you do start giving, what actually starts to come in after you start to give.
Yeah. It's the most fun that you'll ever have with money.
Absolutely, man. Well, listen, man, you've definitely dropped some knowledge, and I know you've opened some people's eyes today. Is there anything that I asked or I didn't ask you that I should have?
You know, I think for the people that are plugged into EXP, that are part of the revenue share of EXP, or the agents that are looking at EXP, the revenue share and the ability to earn stock that doesn't include. It's not existent anywhere else in the industry. Mm-hmm. The ability to go create wealth with those two vehicles, acquiring and purchasing stock at a discount and building revenue share to pay off debt, to pay off your house, to give abundantly, to fund your retirement and your investment, completely passive and effortless. For the most part, it's a tremendous opportunity to just simply take a look at, because it's not anywhere else in this world. And yeah. there's only one place to find it, and that's at EXP. And if you are listening to this and you do want some information about financial coaching, I'm sure Michael will drop it in the show notes on how to get a hold of me. But you can connect with me on Facebook. We can have a private, confidential, you know, conversation. Everything's free. On that front end to just get you started, and then we can go from there.
Awesome, man. Well, listen, I've so enjoyed talking to you. I could probably talk to you for another hour or two. Certainly, we're running out of time here. I hope you and I get to connect again in the future. I know you've definitely opened some people's eyes here today. You know, I just, for me, it's like, you know, it's easier not to look at these things on a daily basis. You understand and know that they're important. But that's why I think it's important that you and I have these conversations.
Yeah, I mean, so we, Melinda and I, my wife and I, lived with our head in the sand for too long. And most people do. And I think when most people take their head out of the sand, they look in the mirror, they realize that they're the problem, but they're also the solution. They make plenty of money, but they're in an industry that, you know, five extra phone calls a day can for 90 days. Will solve all of their financial problems.
Boom. Mic drop, man. Well, listen, Matt, it's been so nice to talk to you again, man. I'm so glad we connected down in Orlando. And as always, I love sharing these stories week after week, because I know EXP is literally changing agents' financial lives, my own included. Do me a big favor. If you know someone that might enjoy the podcast, please share it with them. And if you like the podcast, please go to wherever you listen to podcasts and subscribe. If you want to learn more about why EXP is the fastest growing real estate company in the country, or you're just interested in growing your business, head on over to explodingwealth.com. And if you want to jump on a call one-on-one with me to learn more about my business and how I got to over 300 transactions in 4 years, go to meetmikewald.com. And that's it for this one, folks. All right, brother.